We just got moved into it, all settled in and everything. And late that evening, the foreman came over to me and said, "George, says I got a job for you." "You have experience. You're older than these other." They were college students, all of them young people, you know. Mm-hmm. He said, "I want you to take some dynamite, you and whoever you want to take with you." There's a huge pine tree across the trail. An old pine tree had fallen in a storm or something. And it's got the trail blocked. The thing was about 5 feet high.
Was it a redwood?
Yeah, big, huge redwood. Anyway, he says, "I want you to take in this drill." He give me all the equipment, you know. He says, "You go up there and drill holes, put the dynamite in." And he showed me how to cut a stick of dynamite, you know, and put the cap and the wire in. And he showed me all that. I said, "Yeah, it's no problem." Of course, I thought after coming back from Europe, there wasn't nothing I hadn't seen. Anyway, we got up there. We drilled those holes in that tree. And then standing there on the trail, and it fell right across it. And I could barely look over it. That's how big that monster tree was. I drilled them holes in there, fixed the dynamite sticks, six sticks in a row. And put the fuses on them and wrapped them all into one long fuse. And, it wasn't the type you light. It was electric charge.
Oh, put on one of those where you raise up the plunger and put it down?
Yeah, raise up the plunger.
Okay.
And there's a great big outcropping of rocks laying about 100 feet, 75, 100 feet from where the tree was. I said, "Let's go and get behind that. We should be all right there." We went down there, took the plunger and the whole works, you know. I stuck both of them on there and tightened them down, pulled that up. I said, "Okay, here it goes." And I said, "Boom." Boy, that thing blew. And as God is my witness, I seen snakes flying through there like the wind was blowing them. Nothing grows up there but rattlesnakes. They're just whipping through the air like this. And that,
oh my gosh.
One or two landed real close to us. Of course, they were stunned, you know.
So were you, I bet.
My britches might have been a little. That was a trip, though. And another time, that was in 48. The next year, in 49, I went up there again. To work. And,
go ahead.
I went up there to work again the next year, next spring. And, same job. Old Bob Sharp. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? He went with me. He wanted to give it a try. We got away back in the mountains there. Worked 4 or 5 days, and Bob, he was ready to come home. I can't handle this. Of course, I liked him. He said, "Come on." He said, you go with me, won't you?" I said, "Oh, I don't really want to." I said, "That's good money." Of course, it was back then, you know. He says, "Oh, come on." And he finally talked me into it. I agreed. But I thought we was going to get to ride the horses back. And he said, "No, you quit. You got to walk out." Yeah, that's what the foreman told us. I said, "Well, Lord, I don't feel like walking out." I had bought a brand new pair of field boots, and so had Bob. Before we knew it was going to work up there, we had to have something good. Mm-hmm. You know, we wore that darn pair of shoes out walking out of there.
So you did walk out then?
Yes, we walked out. But along the trail, the foreman told us, he said, "If you keep a fairly good pace," he said, "it'll be a little before dark before you get to the ranger station." And it was. But on the way, we had flashlights. Each one of us had one. Mm-hmm. And the batteries run completely down before we got a little over halfway. Then the batteries were down. It was black, pitch black. And we was having to feel our way along, you know. And I told Bob, I said, Bob, I'm ready to stop. I said, we can't, I don't even know where we're at, and you don't either. He said, no, he said, you can kind of feel the trail. I said, ah, heck. And he said, oh, let's go a little further. I said, all right. So we started going downhill in the forest, stretch of forest there. Started kind of going downhill a little bit like that. And I kept hearing some walking, and I thought it was Bob. And I said, Bob, how the heck did you get behind me? And he said, what'd you say? He would whip out. I said, good gosh, boy, where you at? He said, I'm up here. I turned around and I felt something kind of warm on the back of my neck.
Mm-hmm.
I turned around and he could see, because you couldn't see Ann's funny face. It was that dark. But I smelled that breath and I knew it was a bear. It was following me. And boy, I took off. It didn't matter whether it was a trail or not.
You made a new trail, huh?
I made a new trail, yeah. But you know, we went ahead that whole night, finished off that morning just about first light. We got the trails in, which is a log cabin where they keep supplies, you know.
Uh-huh.
And we were so tired, we just laid down the floor and went out. The next morning, I woke up and there's a big rat sitting right there.
Oh, cool.
Great big huge rat, fast enough. He was eating them supplies and all, really fattened up. And I took my hand and did like that. It just looked at me, and I looked at it. Boy, Bob said, what about her? I said, there's a great big rat here. Boy, he come up right quick.
Might have had to change my pants for the rat, too. No.
Oh, gosh, there's so many stories.
Well, this has been fun.
You
I really appreciate it, yeah.
We'll start another one real quick.
Appreciated you telling us this story. Apparently, Roy's got one more he wants you to ask you about.